I kind of had my last draw when the return leg didn't even get on the pitch. And I've never been one of them footballers who want to sit around. And yes, you know, I could have went to Wembley and had a great day out with Swansea City Football Club, which I would have loved, yes. But, you know, if I had went there and sat on the bench and didn't get on, you know, I wouldn't have felt as though I was celebrating for anything. So it was a hard one to take. I didn't want to leave the football club, but for me, in terms of wanting to play football week in, week out, I felt as though that was the right decision I had to make. So, yeah, I probably knew quite early on that I wouldn't be going to the final, yeah. I think if you see afterwards, I don't know if anyone noticed, but the boys are all celebrating on the pitch and I didn't get on. I just walked down into the tunnel and sat in the change room, and that wasn't out of I wasn't being disrespectful to the players or the fans. It was, you know, I felt as though I didn't contribute on that night, so I didn't deserve to be out there celebrating, if that makes sense. So, you know, that's just who I am as a person. So I went inside and chilled out, and then but I did end up going on the night out afterwards, so it doesn't really make sense.
So even though you played three games, you scored in all three of them?
Yeah.
Because you hadn't contributed on that day?
Yeah. Straight down the tunnel, yeah.
Well, back past Graham could be on here. Danny Graham, chance of Swansea second. He scored! Swansea City will take a 2-0 lead.
Nothing changed, no. I knew after scoring 3-3 and not playing the Chelsea first leg and then scoring again and then not playing again after that, I kind of knew me face wasn't going to fit at this football club with Michael Loud up in charge. So I just felt it was right as a footballer to move on. I didn't want to sit on the bench and not contribute to a team. I wanted to play. Your career's too short to sit around and waste time. So that was my whole reason of moving.
We were talking about it and I was saying, it's incredible. We reached out for the final for the first time. We beat Liverpool at Anfield. We beat Chelsea over two legs. And now it's a failure if we don't win the final. Why? Because we're playing a team from League Two. They have done incredible, but everybody was talking about Bradford, not Swansea. And I think it's fair enough because we're talking about a League Two team, beaten three Premiership teams, Arsenal and Villa over two games. So I just said, well, we have to win. Now it's not, if you have played Liverpool, Man City, Chelsea in the final, Arsenal, Tottenham, well, you said, we're underdog, let's go for it, but we can only do our best. But here, no, said we have to win.
It was a bit strange. It was strange. I think we were a little bit scared, to be honest with you, because, you know, you're playing Bradford and everyone's, oh, you should win this, you should win this. I'm like, yeah, but you never know. And I felt that if they had come out the way that I thought they were going to do, it would have made it a lot more harder. But it helped being on such a massive pitch, the way that we play football. You know, it was once we, you know, got our rhythm, you're not touching us at the end of the day.
It felt different, you know, especially in the semi-final against Chelsea with the underdogs. But we're very much aware that Bradford had already beaten big clubs, you know, Arsenal, Aston Villa. So it wasn't going to be easy. Different style. We knew they had 4-4-2 formation, not much passing, more direct. And they had a fantastic fan base like us. So you could see the Bradford fans from the start, like the Swans fans, were up for it.
It come with a different kind of pressure. It really honestly did, because if you look at it realistically, it should be like one of the best moments going into a final. But the build-up was so, made it so apprehensive, as in like, you've got so much to lose here. You've got so much to lose. And inside, we felt it, but we was never allowed to get to that stage, if you get what I mean. So even, I remember like, I can actually remember now, actually picturing, we was on the coach on the way to the stadium, and I was on the phone to my dad. And I remember him saying, like, there's no prizes for losers. I can still remember him saying that now, actually, which obviously gives me a little smile on my face, but he's right. And yeah, again, it was one of them ones where we were almost on a hiding to nothing, but the way we managed the game and that we played the game, I think we took the stress out of it for not only us, but all the fans there and the fans watching. So it was a great day.
Something that you dream about as a child, and then you know it's a cup final, and we knew we had a real good chance of winning it. So then you're starting to think about, as captain, lifting the trophy. There's not many people that can say they've done that or even been in a position to be close to it. So walking out the tunnel, as you said, friends and family there, all Swans fans there, just an extremely proud moment. And what was nice about that is that team, we all got on so well. So we was all so tight. It was just, I don't know, it was a good day. Obviously, we went up so early in the game and we was comfortable for the whole game. So what it allowed us to do was actually take in the surroundings a little bit and kind of enjoy the day instead of being so, it being so intense that you had kind of wrapped up in the game. This game was a little bit different, where you was a bit detached from it and you could enjoy what was actually happening, which was winning a major trophy.
And everybody have depression or feel depression this moment. Okay, if you are going out against Liverpool or against Chelsea, everybody said, okay, it's normal. But when we met Bradford in the final, we felt the pressure. When we were in the bus going to Wembley, you know, with the Spaniards, because we were playing cards, we said, okay, we must win. Now we must win.
The whole week building up to that game, I was as sick as a dog. I really was. I was, I wasn't good. I even remember after the game, obviously we're all celebrating and I was shivering. I had to go inside because I was shivering. I was really, really bad. So it was pure, pretty much adrenaline that got me through the game. I wasn't good.
I can't remember any game in my career where I had a adrenaline. It was going out of my ears everywhere. It was like I was like in a tunnel going for the preparation of the game. That was amazing. That was amazing. Everything went like in slow motion kind of thing in the preparation. It was my first final as well, big final. So it was amazing. It was amazing.
There's always nerves after a game. I think the moment you step on the pitch, those nerves go. You don't even notice the stands anymore. It's all about the pitch, the green, and your role in the team. And that was exactly the second final. It was about composure, about doing your job properly. You know, we did a lot of homework on Bradford, and we knew the two main threads were the strikers, Naki Wells and the tall guy. I can't remember his name, Branson or something like that. But yeah, we knew if we could control those two players, we had a big chance. And me as a defender, I know my main job first was to stop that and then enjoy going forward.
And the reason we're here is just, 40 or 50 yards away from us, the Capital One trophy. It's decked in amber and white ribbons. Will it be amber or will it be white at the final whistle?
I know in the last year some clubs, they made a new thing about playing one keeper in the one competition, one in the other, one in the league and one in Champions League. But here, in the clubs I've been, I said, we have one goalkeeper, first goalkeeper, he's playing in the league. If he's fit, he plays. But then in the cup, we have to play the second goalkeeper. I did it in Getafe, where we reached the final, and I also did it in Swansea. In the first games, no problem, but the further you go, and then when you reach the final, you can see, of course, the first goalkeeper, he wants to play. But I think Gerhard, he deserved to play all the games. You cannot say, okay, now you played from the first round to the semi-final. Oh, please sit out there, because no, he had to play all the games, and I think that was fair.
I played for many clubs in Germany as well, and you know when this is a one-time chance in your life, and with that kind of feeling, I also went into the final. I knew this is the game, and this will be your last chance to win a trophy.
Yeah, there's a good crew of us. I think I used all my allocation for that game, but it was It was a special day.
Yeah, I had loads, yeah. And it's funny, everyone's like, oh yeah, I'm going to be here, I'm going to be there. Have a look at me. You know, I'm looking, you just see a sea of people. I'm like, did you not see me waving? No. But yeah, I had loads of people come down. Obviously my wife and her family, my family, mum and dad, friends, you know, everybody was there in full force. So it was amazing. And the atmosphere was just incredible. Just to see that amount of people there was wild, yeah.
The Swansea City class of 2013 looking to write themselves into the club history books.
I was so pleased with the performance, but because we, from the first second to the last moment, were completely 100% in control of the game. Not in one moment I had a feeling, oof, not even in the first 5 minutes. We took the ball, we had the ball the whole time, and when we scored the first goal, I said to Alan, we won. No, no, Michael. We won.
Cleared away by Key. Swansea haven't got it fully clear. They will now, though. Lovely ball from De Guzman to send Routledge down the middle. Routledge attacking. Michu's on his left. This is Michu. Head to the penalty area. Michu shoots. It's safe. But Dyer has fallen up. It's first blood to Swansea City in the League Cup final. Nathan Dyer runs all the way towards Michael Laudrup. The Swans are celebrating. Swansea City 1, Bradford City 0.
Oh, it was amazing. I really wanted to score when we played at Wembley in the playoff final. And that was something I was desperate to do, and I didn't manage to do it. So scoring then was, yeah, I mean, I remember turning and running all the way down the other end to our fans, you know. So to be able to say you scored at Wembley is incredible. Not many people get to, you know, play at Wembley for a start, and to score, yeah, it was amazing.
I mean, to be honest with you, even the way we started the game and I can't remember ever touching the ball for the first few minutes. So we started the game and we set our mark out straight away. But as soon as we got that first goal, it was almost like, okay, let's just do our job. And as soon as we did that, it was almost like utopia.
The goal was a Nathan Dyer tap-in. Oh, lovely ball. Threads through to Michu into the penalty area. Shoot! 2-0! Michu! You just knew when it fell to him, he would not miss. He's buried it into the bottom corner. He does what he does best.
Well, I remember Ben celebrating with me. He was my roomie. He's a really good friend, so we spoke all the season. And when we scored the second one, we felt we were the championship.
Will Matu get time to take the goal kick? He doesn't. It's been another dominant first half at Wembley by Swansea City. They took a grip on the game against Reading in the Championship playoff final. They've taken a firmer hold on this one with goals from Nathan Dyer and who else? Inevitably, Michu. Swansea City in total control at halftime. They are within sight of their first major trophy. Halftime at Wembley. Swansea City 2, Bradford City 0.
It happened when we played Reading as well, and we thought it was over at halftime, and you could see what happened. Obviously, different scenario, you know, playing against a League 2 club. We are 2-0 down, different manager, different slightly style of play. But with Laudrup, we never thought of shooting back. He was always trying to score as many as we can, you know, because we knew we had the players for that. With ultimately a very strong defensive core in the team with Ashley Williams, you know, Liam Britton in the middle, myself being there for a few years.
I felt like it was a little bit different. I think we knew we were in control of this game. Like I said, they didn't come out the way that we thought they were going to do, and they made things a little bit easy for us. Being able to pass and knock it around and kind of drift into any positions we wanted to. So that's when we kind of started to have a little bit of fun and probably do things that we wouldn't have done in other matches. Wouldn't say showboating, but you know, that extra couple of passes more just to make it look good. So yeah, it was, I think after half time, everyone was just wanted to get on the score sheet then. It was like, who else can score?
Tries to slide it through, but Key comes out of the defence, does the Korean. for Swansea City to the first goal scorer, Dyer. Makes good taste on that right-hand side, slides it through to Michu, little miss by Michu. Dyer again into the penalty area, 3-0! Dyer has netted a second, and the oh-so-cool Laudrup punches the air in delight. Swansea City are surely there now.
I don't like to see games where one team is humiliated. You know, a game where you're 3-0, one team is 3-0 down after 30 minutes, or maybe one player down, one player less on the pitch, and you say, oof, this could be 7-8 with no problem. I don't like that. That's not the same to say, oh, stop playing. But it is, I think it was on the penalty. The goalkeeper got the red card. So they played with one less when we were 4-0 up, and it was still 20 minutes or something to play.
De Guzman putting on a show now. I tell you, Routledge showing some tricks. Dyer, Michu, it's mesmerising stuff sometimes. They move it really quickly when they get in that final third of the Bradford half. Chacho Hernandez through to Michu, back inside. Oh, De Guzman is brought down. Penalty surely by Duke. Yeah. The ball rolls past the post. It's a chance for four. Who will take it? It's got to be Nathan Dyer, hasn't it? Wow. Oh, no, hang on. It's not. Oh, yes, it is.
In the game, it was over. It was finished. It was not that I said, hey, players, hey, calm. Don't humiliate. No. But the players, they did it themselves. They could see the game is over. Why go for 6, 7, or 8?
It sounds belittling. But there's obviously a human side and a human aspect of it. No one should take away the fact of what they did that year. They beat Arsenal, they beat Villa. They had an unbelievable run, and you think of what they did that year and what they achieved. So to be a game, probably the biggest game of their lives, to be in a situation where, you know, we've all been in it before. Like we spoke before, we lost. When the build-up to the second leg of the Chelsea game, we lost 5-0 at Anfield. And we've all been on the back of them, and it's not really nice. So there's a human element to it. I'm not going to say, obviously, we downed tools and stuff like that, but we did what we did.
Now then, this is interesting. Swansea's first penalty this season. It looks to me as if De Guzman and Dyer are arguing about who should take it. Dyer wants to take it. De Guzman has the ball. Meanwhile, Matt Duke makes the shameful walk off. It's a shame for him, really.
They're arguing that the Guzman... Oh, it's a shame for the keeper, without a shadow of doubt.
And they are arguing it.
The captain has got to go of Ashley Williams.
And Ashley Williams.
Sort out to Guzman and Nathan Dyer. You know, there's one person taking it. They shouldn't be seen to be arguing over it.
It is true that day, for some reason, we did not talk about what... And sometimes you write on the papers in the dressing room, free kicks, who is in the wall, who's taking it from the left, from the right, a corner from left, corner from right, and then in the end, penalty. And that day, I don't think we put penalty Jonathan, but it was Jonathan. So yes, I was a little laughing inside myself because I could understand them both. One, because he was the one to take the penalty, and the other because he could score a hat-trick in a final, maybe only time in his life.
I remember when we won the penalty, it was Ben Davis that came up to me and said, take it, because normally I don't go up for penalties. It's not, you know, necessarily my thing to do. So it was Ben that said, Nath, take the penalty, you're on your hat-trick. And I thought, oh yeah, you know, I was so engrossed in the game, I didn't realise. So I thought, okay, you know, let's go and take it, you know, to score a hat-trick. When I kind of asked for the ball, thinking he'd say, you know, yeah, because I said, oh, can I have it? So I'm on my hat trick. He said no. And you know, if it's one of them ones where, you know, when you're expecting somebody just to say yeah, and it kind of threw me back. And then I think the more and more it kind of went on, it was a situation going on, I think, with the goalkeeper or whatever. So it kind of happened to just keep going, and I was getting angry and angry at the time. And I thought, is anyone gonna back me up? You know, I was like, Ash, you know, even the gaffer I was looking over, no one was saying to let me take it. And I think for the designated penalty taker, we didn't actually have one, because I know that Michu had scored penalties through the season. De Guzman had taken some, you know, loads of players had taken penalties. So it was not like we had one penalty taker like you normally do. And also, even if you are, if somebody's on a hat-trick, for me, that's, you know, it's a one in a million times. No one's Erling Haaland that can score four hat-tricks in a season. So it was a chance for me to have that. And also to be the first player, I think it was the first, I would have been the first player in history to have scored a hat-trick in a League Cup final. So, yeah, I think a lot of it came into it. So when I asked the Guzman about it, he said, you know, oh, I want to score as well. And it turns out he scored two, didn't he? So, but look, you know, it happened. I would have loved to have scored a hat-trick. It didn't. I just took man of the match instead. So.
If that was me, I probably would have used my length at the club to tell Jonathan de Guzman, I'm taking it, mate. You got no say here. And I think Nathan probably could have done the same, but Nathan isn't me. But you're asking me if it was me, my answer would have been, I'm taking it, mate. No one has scored a hat-trick before in a final in British football, I believe. So, yeah, I would have done that.
You can go back and you can wrap it up however you want. It would have been an incredible achievement for Nathan to score a hat-trick, get man on a match, win the final. And again, it would have been great. Obviously, I understand Jono's point where he wants to score and, you know, it is what it is. But for me, I would have loved to see Nath score a hat-trick at Wembley.
In the end, I think it was fair that it was Jonathan, because, but it also put a lot of pressure on him. Even if it was 3-0 to 4, and even if he had missed the penalty, we would have won anyway. But for him, after those arguments with Nathan, it was a lot of pressure on him. He scored the goal, and after we changed some moments, we changed and we make a change with Dyer came out. And he goes, coach, I wanted to, yeah, I understand. Go. And then after the game, there was nothing. It was okay.
Up against the substitute McLaughlin. De Guzman hits it, scores for Swansea City. 4-0 it is. Jonathan De Guzman waves to the Swans fans.
I mean, I remember I was laughing with Ashley Williams. I remember, I think I touched one ball in the first half. And then in the second half, I think it was 3-0, and then we got this penalty or something like this. So we were 4-0 up, and then Ash turned around and came towards me and he started laughing. And I was like, you can't laugh now. We are still not finished, although it was 4-0, you know? Because you've seen crazy things in football, no? But at that time, I also had to smile a little bit because it was just too good. No, we were just too good for them.
We won the game. It's 20 minutes left. Let's play it around the people. And both fans were still celebrating. And I was thinking that was also one of the moments of that game. Of course, I understand the Swansea part, winning 4-0. But also the others, they were not celebrating this game. They were celebrating the competition they had that season, where they had done fantastic, you know. So that was a great picture there to see both Bradford and Swansea fans celebrating, even if one team was winning at that moment 4-0.
Hitting from there, but they're still on the attack. Rob, let you back in. Here we go again. 2 minutes left. Ball to the net. It is five. It's five for Swansea City, and it's Jonathan De Guzman who steps into the six-yard box and pokes it in from close range. His second, Swansea City's fifth.
For me, I was always having the dream to play in the Premier League. That was always my dream because, as a child, I was dreaming this because I love English football and I love the atmosphere there. So that was always a dream of mine. But of course, who can imagine that you win a major trophy with a team like Swansea?
No. Honestly, no. But, you know, the club is on such an upward trajectory. You look back and you think, well, why would it not be possible? Why should it not be possible? I mean, you described it at the beginning of the interview where, you know, you might not win the league because that might be one step too far, but in a cup competition, in a one-off game, we can beat anybody. So why shouldn't we actually have aspirations to try and win a trophy. And the fact that we actually achieved that, and in the manner that we did, just spoke volumes of the club, the players, the staff, and the city as a whole at that time.
No, not really. I didn't think that I'd be, you know, lifting a trophy at Wembley as captain of a team. Even going through, you know, all the phases of my life up to that point, I didn't really imagine it. You kind of dream about it or think about it, but it wasn't something like on the you know, to-do list. So it was like a nice bonus, really, to be honest, if I'm being honest, because there's plenty of players that were better than me and ended their career and not won any silverware. So I was lucky to, you know, as you say, to do the bus tours around Swansea and, you know, walk the stairs and lift a trophy and well, two. And just, you know, just grateful, really, of those opportunities, and just nice that I got to do it with such a good fan base and such a good, you know, group of staff and teammates.
I'm going to be honest now, because it's, of course, it's difficult to win a trophy, but for the top teams as well, Liverpool, City, okay, they have money to win trophies every year, but it will be difficult even for them. When I signed on Swansea, I couldn't imagine that. I mean, the first year's impossible, but we did it. And I remember this night was really a lot. Yeah.
No, that's what I said. I mean, I genuinely just grew up wanting just to play football. That was all my thought process was, you know, it's never titles or silverware or individual titles. It was just more, I just wanted to play good football. You know, I wanted to be in a team that, you know, played the way that I saw how football should be played. And that was here. You know, I was on loan at Sheffield, actually, and we played Swansea. I remember I was in the tunnel and had a few words with Roberto at the time, and he said that he'd think that I'd fit in really well here. Didn't really know much about Swansea because obviously they just came up from League One. And then when I watched the game, I just thought this can't be real, you know, the way that they were playing. And I think that Swansea lost in the end, 1-0 to Sheffield. And I wasn't really playing, I was in and out of the team, so my mind was already made up. I was coming down here to play, and, you know, I've never looked back.
It's a major honour to win any trophy, and to do that for your hometown club is obviously even more special. But it was, it was an amazing day.
Yeah, living the dream, of course, when you see... 5 years before that, I was still a League One player in Spain, still working as an accountant, chasing the dream to become a professional first. So yeah, to come here, and I remember Roberto telling me in 4 years this club is going to be in the Premier League. I laughed. I said, "We're in League One." He said, "Yeah, but don't worry." I said, "Okay." Budget was tight. I was like, "Okay." And then it happened. And then a year later, after promotion, as you say, achieving that much, I was pinching myself, of course, you know, but I think that's what makes dreams come true special, because you're chasing it, you work hard for it, and it happens. So I think that's an example that if you believe and you work hard for it, you can do it. I know you need luck and others around you to do it, but yeah, Swansea as a whole city, club, team, they all believe in the same thing and we achieve it.
Monk hammers it away. He'll be lifting the trophy soon. It was a little limp. You don't want to limp, you've got to climb those steps, Gary Monk. Along with Ashley Williams, Rangel out to Hernandez. He hasn't scored, but he's been a major, major architect of this. Little couple of step overs into the penalty area. Pablo Hernandez lays it back, can't find his strike. Palmichu, and it's out for a throw-in. Swansea City have won the Capital One Cup. Clear the Liberty Stadium cabinet. The Swans have their hands on their first major trophy. It's been a stroll at Wembley, but they'll go marching into Europe next season.
I remember after the final and with the celebration on the pitch, and we went up the stand and we took the trophy. After that, we went back into the dress rooms, and I was the last who went out of the dress room because I wanted to enjoy every single second, because I know this is a one-time thing, and I didn't want to go back to normal, like, okay, game done, shower, bus, home. So I remember I was sitting there. It's quite big there in Wembley. You have a lot of rooms there too, in the dress room. And I was sitting there, and I think I was drinking a beer, and I was just trying to suck in everything, no? And trying, because I wanted to remember this even 20, 30, 40 years after, no? When I'm old, I still want to have that memory of being there in Wembley, that moment. And so that was my idea. So it took me ages to get out of the dress room. There was a party then organized by the club in a hotel next to Wembley. And I think I was the last who went there. They were already, the players, they were all there already. And I came last, and I enjoyed even the walk from the stadium to the hotel. It was phenomenal. Yeah, it was phenomenal.
So the celebrations were a bit strange because we knew we'd won the game for so long. It wasn't like the Reading game where we won it late on and it was like elation. It was like an almost like planned celebration in the dressing rooms. We knew we'd won from probably the first half, so it wasn't as jubilant as you might think, but it was still a good one, and we still enjoyed it because it was something that before that season we'd never even thought of achieving.
It was heavy. It was a heavy one.
I think we had a good goal. We enjoyed ourselves after it. Look, it was something we all realised that was a huge achievement, and how difficult it would be for the Swans to do that again. And it was fun, but it was a very like family orientated club at that time. Everybody was together. Everybody was celebrating with each other, and it was an hour where I'll have a lot of memories.
The gaffer, Michael, was a player, and he knows about celebrating, he knows about winning titles. For me, it was the unique title in my career. So we had a long night in London, yeah.
I remember I was too drunk. The celebrations were different. It wasn't a life-changing moment like the promotion to the Premier League. I'll give you that. And that was a special moment, but a major trophy is a major trophy, you know, when, where it was one of those things where we couldn't wait to get back to Swansea, go on the open bus again and share those moments with the whole city, you know, where we look at each other and like, we're like, what's going on? How can we achieve that much? But again, it's all down to recruitment, hard work, and how good of a place Swansea was at the time.
You have to understand, when you're in the moment, right? So you have to actually take what you've actually done and understand what you've done. I don't think any of us did at the actual moment, because it's just, like I said, you just game after game after game, and you have a game in 6 days and back to the league and blah, blah, blah. But it was great. I still remember actually holding the trophy, bringing it to the fans. I remember, was it Chico? We all jumped over Chico. We squashed him at the bottom of a pile when he couldn't, yeah, with his flag when he was doing the ole and stuff. So it was just a great time for everybody. I remember after the game, we shaved our sports scientist's hair off. I remember.
Really?
Yeah, in the changing room. So he came out of that looking good. But yeah, it was just a great time. Whoever you speak to at that time, I think even the ones not playing and stuff would have said like, it was a great time to be around. Now they look back, it was a great time to be around the squad and the club and the city, you know, it's thriving. So it was a great time.
You know, everyone was just going wild. I think just your emotions took over then, and, you know, we all got on the bus back and had our little parade tour. And yeah, everyone was just so happy. You know, it was nice to see how united again that we made the city. Everyone came out again in force, and You know, to be able to say that we've won, you know, League Cup, you know, it's wild. And if you run through the list of winners, you know, we stand out. You see Swansea and Man United and Chelsea and all those teams. So, yeah, the celebrations were wild. I won't go into it.
It's brilliant for the fans. It's a major cup and, you know, everyone's still on a high.
That was a funny thing, because we were making fun of the situation. We were down in the Marriott Hotel when the bus came, and it was empty. It was a coldish day, typical Swansea day, and we didn't see any people. And we thought, like, oh, there will be maybe a few hundred, they will be there, because we didn't see anyone. And we drove, I remember, we came up from the train station, I think we came out, and we didn't see anyone. We thought, like, where are we going? There's not much happening, no? And then all of a sudden, we saw this huge crowd in front of us, and we were like, what the hell? Where are they coming from? They're not working? What are they doing here? And we couldn't believe it. And then it was, yeah, obviously, then it was big celebration, enjoying all the, every minute, literally, seeing so many people there, and... Although it was freezing cold, I would have loved to have it in the summer or in a sunny day. But there we go. It was fantastic. But at the start, I remember we were like, there will not be many people, because we didn't see anyone on the street. No one with a Swans shirt. No one at the Marriott Hotel singing or anything like this. It was quiet. It was literally quiet. And we went into this bus, open deck bus, and we were like, "Oh, it's cold. Where are we going? There's not many people." And then we turned into that St. Helens Road, and then it was like, it was amazing.
There's a difference when you win something for the first time. And this was for the first time of a club where we came back. I think that was a huge moment for all of us. And because you're not only winning, because it was the first time.
It was my best thing. I remember with really, really impressive feeling in my body, and was really incredible. Yeah.
Yeah, it was wild. It was wild. It was. That was a very surreal moment as well, because I remember having a picture with my mom. With the trophy, and then obviously we did the tour around the city on the bus and the streets. There was no pavement. It was crazy. It was amazing. It showed you what it meant to everybody. It wasn't just us or the football club. It was the whole city. So that the whole city was at that point was one, and we was all going in the same direction. We were always trying to say achieve the same thing, and thankfully enough, we actually brought a trophy back.
When you reach something for the first time, it gives a completely special feeling, and that we had that day after the final here, when we came back to Swansea, it was really incredible. Right?
Yeah, I know we had to play a couple of qualifiers, Malmo and I can't remember the other club, but yeah, it was definitely another goal, which obviously, as you say, achieve the Premier League, achieve a major trophy, now is Europe, which probably the last time Swansea played in Europe was in the 80s. So again, we can make history here. So yeah, it was great. You know, we had a great experience there. We went to a few countries, and I think it's when you realize Swansea's in the map now, whole Europe, whole world. And playing a great brand of football.
Yeah, it was great. I also remember that game in Valencia. It was special also for me, but I think it was even more special for the Spanish players. I remember that Angel was very important, because he came to Swansea from lower league, lower rank in Spain, and suddenly for him to play in Valencia against Valencia was big. And I remember that I named him captain for that game, so he was captain in Europe for that game, and it was fantastic. Even if I I remember they had a red card in the first half. We played much better than them, 3-0 something. Yeah, so it was a huge win. Yes.
Sometimes I do forget I played in Europe, you know, and there's a surreal feeling, you know, going over to these different countries to play. You know, playing against Napoli, which I thought at the time we played unbelievable. We should have won that game. Valencia, you know, and the football that we played as well. You know, it wasn't just we went there just to make up the numbers. We played really well and done really well. It was difficult with the games on the days it was, especially then playing in the league games. It was quite fatiguing. And then you had the cup games in between that as well. So I can kind of see where teams and managers do complain about it because it's quite late on in the week. But yeah, to be able to say you played in Europa League, to play at certain stadiums, again, is amazing.
Look, it's a nice thing to obviously play in Europe and stuff, but it was more of a nicer thing to do it with the group that we had. And in fact, looking back, we should have went further than we did. I think we should have beat Napoli. We played more than well enough to beat them over the two legs, but obviously it wasn't meant to be. I remember that bus journey home after that game. It wasn't great, but yeah, it just allowed the club to go to, again, to try and take the club to another level. So we kept on building and building and building and trying to progress. And obviously playing in Europe comes with its own problems, right? So your schedule becomes extremely hectic. Your pre-season starts way earlier. Your season starts way earlier. So obviously there were struggles that season as well. And it wasn't all rosy and shiny, but, and again, it was just another experience.
Where do you think winning the League Cup ranks in your career?
In my career, it's a very, very, it's a second. I don't think that anything can beat the playoff final, purely just for the fact that, you know, where Swansea came from and then to achieve the ultimate, just to play in the Premier League and to stay there for so many years. I think that was, that's one of the best achievements that this city's had. Don't get me wrong, the League Cup is unbelievable as well, but to have that Premier League status, and that badge was incredible. And the way that we did it, you know, that game against Forest and, you know, even the final, you know, your hair's on ends, you know. So definitely League Cup second and playoff final first and Premier League somewhere in between.
gotta be top two, you know. I think getting promoted to Premier League is number one. League Cup is number two, and after that I'd say probably Valencia away in the Europa League. It's probably my third one because of what it meant as a Spanish player going back to my home country. I couldn't reach even second division football, so to go back as a Premier League player in Europa League and beating Valencia, big club, 3-0, being captain, obviously was also special. So yeah, great memories.
Oh, it's a top. It's the biggest achievement I have in my career. I mean, I had some milestones, no, during my career, and certainly I had special games, special moments. But this is the biggest moment. I mean, to win a major trophy with Swansea, you always have to repeat that. No, it's not that I played for Arsenal or I played for a big team, because they always have good chances to win it at the end.
It's up there with me, obviously. That I dice with that and getting promoted with Crystal Palace. I really do. Obviously, I learned and grew up in South London, and Palace was my team and gave me a platform to play, and I wouldn't be here without that. But obviously, to win a trophy, because you look at it holistically, right? You can only win a league and two cups, and maybe if you're lucky, Europe, right? So there's only three trophies a year, and look how many teams there are. So to win that, and to win with the squad and for the city that obviously gave me a platform to play and share so much, which was just for me, I can't decide between the two.
I always say to my friends that one of the best stadiums I played in UK was Liverpool away, because of the crowd. But if I just can't say one game. I just always say Wembley, never in the final. We won the trophy with all the crowd. For me, it was the worst feeling in my career. The top game.
It's true. I won 5 league titles in Spain with Barcelona and Madrid. Yes, I won the Champions League. Yes, I won the Italian league. Yes, I won the Dutch league. But that was with Barcelona, Real Madrid, Juventus, and Ajax, and all favorites to win something in a season. Here with Swansea, and not only winning, but winning and on the way beating the Liverpool on Anfield and Chelsea over 2 games. I think that made this, and very important to remember, first major trophy for this club ever. And who knows when the next one will be. And I think that is important. If you win a FA Cup or League Cup with Liverpool or Man United or Chelsea, yeah, it's one more to the room. It's nice, but yeah, we put them together with all the others. But this one will be remembered. That's why we're sitting here talking about the 10-year anniversary for this trophy, and that's why for me it will always remain something special in my career as a player and as a coach.
To the ball and on the right side towards the back post, looking for Luke Moore, heads it across goal and it's chipped in.
The corner comes in towards the far post. Monk with a header and the goalkeeper stopped it and it's gone over his head as Michu breaks away for Swansea City into the penalty area. Chance to sew it up, puts it across. It's 3-1. They give the ball away. Michu now into the penalty area. He scored! Swansea City have won the Capital One Cup. Clear the Liberty Stadium cabinet. The Swans have their hands on their first major trophy after a 5-star display at the home of English football.